Praise the Lord. So it's 5 o'clock. So last week, Dr. David Wong was sharing about breakfast with Jesus, how Jesus invites us to come and fellowship with him. Well, obviously now it's not breakfast time, it's coming dinner actually. But still it's the same. In service, God is inviting us to come and share and fellowship with him. And that's what we're going to be doing very soon, right? So I invite you to stand up together with me. We're going to recite the Apostles' Creed. Right, take a moment. We're going to Apostles' Creed. Okay. So, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So Lord, we thank you for this time. As we gather together from various places, we put our hearts before you, we focus on you. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and just commune with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone say,
Amen.
Amen. Let's give God a big hand.
Let's give God all the praises. Give him a round of applause. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Woo!
For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Amen. Today as we sing to the Lord, let's think about the work of Jesus and how through his blood we are reconciled to God's covenant people. We thank you, Lord.
Things of heaven will grow strange, leading.
Hashem. You came to fulfill the laws and the prophets, so that we might be accepted through grace and to God's family. We love you, Lord.
thank you, O Lord, that today, O Lord, you are seated at the right hand of the Father. You ever live to make intercession for your people. So we come before you, God, and ask that you hear our prayers, you hear our cries. Let this kingdom that we belong to, O God, be a kingdom of joy, a kingdom of peace, a kingdom of righteousness, a kingdom, O God, where we experience your power to save, your power to heal, your power to restore. We commit ourselves to you today and ask, O Lord, that your presence move so strongly and mightily in each and every one of us, in our lives, in our hearts. We commit ourselves and our family to you, O Lord. Bless us as we turn our face and trust in you. Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we honor you and worship you today. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone say, Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. You know, we have just gone through the whole series of Isaiah, and at the end, we see that God has a Messiah that is coming, and his kingdom is a kingdom that knows no end. And we are seeing that now today, as a church, we are part of that kingdom. So turn to your neighbor on your left and right and say that Jesus is your King. Amen. All right. Can you just do that for me? Amen. Come on, let's be seated now. Thank you, singers and musicians, for leading us today. You know that we're not done this actually in our services, and that is every time we have a refreshment at level one, there's always a cell group that is anchoring to provide the refreshment, and we have never really appreciated the cell groups. Okay, so even though the next time we have fellowship will be a while's time, but I thought we're just going to start. And so this time round, this week, it was, I don't know what is the name of the cell group, but it is the cell group that is in Woodleigh, and together with Andrew Wong, the whole cell group is actually, I'm the cell group leader, okay? So, yeah, so I just want to thank all of you, Melissa, Augustine, and Karen, and Justin, everyone who was involved in helping to prepare the food. Okay, so then next time, whichever cell group is involved, we're just going to give thanks, and we're just going to appreciate them, okay? Yeah, I'm just going to ask John to come and give the announcement and collect the offering, then I'll share the word of God.
All right, so we have a few announcements today. The first one, of course, if you're new here with us today, we welcome you to join us here at Christ Gospel Fellowship. So if you have, you can see, if you'd like to know more about us, you can scan the QR code, or there's also a slot at the back where if you'd like us to contact you, then you just leave your particulars with us and we can do that for you, all right? And the next thing is about, so last weekend, Dr. David Wong, I think he shared, and so he brought some of his books for us. So some of the books are still available. There are three books that are still available if you like to purchase, and they are His Breakfast with Jesus, and also the two more books that he has. So it's still available if you want to. So just, and the next thing is that Pastor Tan already mentioned that, so from now, from 13th of July to August, basically the hall downstairs will not be available for us to use. So looks like we're going to find another way of having more fellowship. But I think you will find that Pastor Tan is going to be sharing more about how moving forward we can find ways when we do fellowship, we can learn to be able to speak more, share more, not just about our lives, but also about our own Christian walk and about things of God. So you're going to have that chance. And so with that, I'm going to wait on you as we take the offering. All right, so there's boxes at the back, but there's still a QR code that can be flashed on the screen. And so I wait on you to really pray about it and also give to the Lord the offering to the church. So, Father, we thank you that we have this privilege to be able to contribute to your kingdom of God. So as we give, we pray, bless the offering, bless it for our good use, And we just want to entrust the service to your hands, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And I would like to, today, I think we're going to start on Ephesians. So the scripture reading is going to be done by Cassandra. Is Cassandra here? Yeah, I'd like to invite you. You can come over and can do the scripture reading for us. It's okay, take our time.
Ephesians 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. Verse 11. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. Amen.
Thank you, Cassandra. Now, as you can see, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14, it's quite a lot of, it's quite chunky in terms of the number of words. Actually, in the original Greek, it's one sentence. And it is made up of 202 Greek words. So that's why it's in our scripture reading. I will go through it. But I find that one of the purpose of us doing like a book study is, besides giving you a sermon, I want to try to break it down, so that it's easier for you the next time when you study this passage, you at least have a framework to work on, and then you can actually receive much better. All right. Now, yes, like what John said, we will go into a new book on Ephesians. But what I would like to do, we are going to do maybe about 4 or 5 sessions. Okay, is we are. I'm going to first look at Ephesians chapter 1 to 3. This week, and then chapter 4 to 6 next week. It's not the usual way we do sermons, because we usually take chapter 1, but I find that if I do chapter 1 and chapter 2 and 3, it will take a while for you to see the bigger picture. So if I can cover on a more aerial view, a higher view, if you know how to use Google Map, right? Sometimes you can zoom in on a particular building, or you can zoom out and see a wider landscape. So if you can see the scriptures this way, then you get the gist of the message easier. Then when you go back and read it, you will find that you can understand the structure better, okay? And you may get more out of it. Ephesians is a very theologically rich book, and there are a lot of familiar passages, and also not so familiar passages. For example, by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourself, is a gift of God. It's in Ephesians. Therefore, put on the whole armor of God. Those verses are in Ephesians. But there are also other verses that maybe to you and to me in the past may not be so important, because you don't really remember or memorize them. But I believe after today, as you hear this sermon and you look at the structure, you will see that maybe those verses that we think are very, very important and we memorize them may not really be the main thing that Paul was trying to get at. He was trying to get at something else. Okay? And so we will see that a little bit later. Now, when we look at Ephesians chapter, this whole book, I want to go into the background. Okay? So the title of my message today is this: A New Humanity in Christ, and we will begin by going through the background. you'll find that there is this PDF sent out in the WhatsApp group chat. Please, if you have, if you can, just open it up. It will help you. It's a lot of text, okay, and it will be beneficial. The geography of Ephesus is a coastal city situated in modern-day Turkey today. I think some of you have been there before. I've not been there, but there are some, you know, biblical land tours that is organized by tour agency. One of these days, okay, we will probably go there. And then you look at all the seven churches in Revelation is in this area, Turkey, okay, Asia Minor. It's a cosmopolitan and multi-ethnic place in the time of Paul. The Greeks and then followed by the Romans came and colonized it. And because it's a place for trade, it's near the coast, right? Then there are people from many, many different places will come, even from Egypt. As far as Egypt, they'll be there. From Israel, from the Jews, they will all be residing in the area. The city of Ephesus in antiquity is among the largest cities in the Roman Empire, the entire empire. Of course, the largest will be Rome, then probably followed by Alexandria in Egypt. And some scholars think that Ephesus will probably be the third largest city. Now, it's religiously pluralistic. Okay, they say that maybe there are about over 50 gods and goddesses that was being worshipped in Ephesus, including Greek gods, Egyptian gods, pagan rituals, and divination. And these are all important for us to know in terms of the background, which will help us in understanding this book. Most prominent was the large temple dedicated to the worship of the Ephesian Artemis, also known as Diana by the Roman name. Okay, now, today, if you go to Ephesus, it's one of the tourist spots where the ruins of the temple of Artemis is now considered as one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. But it's in ruins. Okay, so just pillars. So in Acts chapter 19, verse 35, if you want to know a little bit more about Ephesus in the time of Paul, Acts chapter 19 is the account of Paul in Ephesus, his ministry, his breakthrough, and how the church was started. And you see this verse in verse 35, it says, "And when the town clerk had quieted the crowd, he said, 'Men of Ephesus, who is there who does not know that the city of the Ephesians is temple keeper of the great Artemis and of the sacred stone that fell from the sky?'" So it's like a well-known thing that if you are the people of Ephesus will know that the main goddess is Artemis. Okay, so therefore, I'm going to show you a picture. And this is how the Ephesian Artemis looks like in a statue and an idol form. Okay, so you can see that actually she's very well ornamented. She wears a skirt and there are panels on the skirt with animals, wild animals like lions and so on. They are in a submitted pose or posture, which shows that she is like the queen of heaven, and these animals are under her rule. Okay, and there are, which you cannot see in the picture, but there are zodiac signs across her chest. Okay, we understand zodiac, yeah, so it's not the Chinese Sun Xiao, but the English zodiac, which signifies that she had power over fate. Okay, in that time. And scholars are speculating, they are not 100% sure, what are these little bags, like these round little bags that is hung around her chest. They suspect that it could be bags that contain magical materials, like for casting of spells, divination, for pagan worship, those kind of things hang around that pins to this local goddess. Okay, so this is the kind of superstition, this is the kind of worship that the people of Ephesus have at that time. And it's not just the people of Ephesus, people go there to worship Artemis. So Paul, what about his own relationship with Ephesus? He was in Ephesus around AD 52 to 55, and he spent about 3 years. Acts chapter 19 tells us that he spent about 3 years in Ephesus, and the whole Asia Minor, which is present day today Turkey, heard the word of God. So it's almost like you can imagine Paul set up like a Bible school with his headquarters in Ephesus, and the word of God spread in that region. So this letter to the Ephesians was likely written between AD 61 to 62, a few years after the church got started. Two most notable events, which you can find in Acts chapter 19, of Paul's ministry in Ephesus that resulted in a breakthrough is the story of the sons of Sceva. Sceva is actually a Jewish high priest. He has seven sons. So when there was a particular man who had was demon-possessed, these seven sons of Sceva went to the man and say, I cast you out, right, in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. And then the man replied, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? Okay, that very familiar passage. And then the man leaped onto the sons of Sceva and tore away their clothes so that they fled the scene naked. That's what Acts chapter 19 tells us. Now, because of this event, a lot of the people in Ephesus at that time, they saw the power of Jesus and even the demons, right? The demons say, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? So they saw that and they came and they brought out all their magical books, incantations and so on. And the Bible says in Acts 19 that it cost, they set a bonfire and the price of all these materials maybe amounted to 50,000 silver coins or something like that. So it's a lot of magic, a lot of superstition in that area. And because of Paul and his ministry, a lot of people were converted. They turned from the worship of Artemis into the worship of Jesus. And the people who were trading, they sell the statue of Artemis, or they make money through the temple, they are now losing their business. And as they lose their business, they raise up a mob and had a riot against Paul. Okay, so that's the notable story of this whole entire scene in Acts chapter 19. All right. Now, with this theme in mind and this background, the superstition, Artemis, etc., when we now analyze this letter, I want to introduce to you this this British pastor and also a theologian, John Stott. Some of you may have heard him. I read his books. This is how he breaks down the book of Ephesians. So I have a chance to read the book of Ephesians with John Stott's commentary in Changi. Okay. So if you know, you know. Okay. So, and I've been so blessed by it. But today, I want to just give to you the 4 points, okay, of how John Stott breaks down this book. He looks at chapter 1, verse 3 to 2, chapter 2, verse 10, as the new life which God has given to us in Christ. And then the key word is point number 2, the second part of the book, is the new society which God has created through Christ. Now, that's what I am trying to express to you by saying that there are many verses that are very familiar. For example, put on the armor of God, but you're saved by grace through faith and so on. But really, if you read the whole book, the highlight of the book is point 2. This new society or this new humanity that God has formed in Christ, made up of Jews and Gentiles. This traces, of course, all the way back to God's promise to Abraham that through Christ, through your seed, the nations of the earth will be blessed. So actually, the book of Ephesians is a good book to study after Isaiah, because after we study Isaiah and we see how the messianic hope that one will come and that the nations will come to God in the restoration, the book of Ephesians is that book that will actually show us that. All right, so then point number 3 will be, with this new society or this new humanity that God has formed or created in Christ, how should you live your life? So that's where chapter 4 and chapter 5 comes in. The new standards which God expects of his new society, especially unity and purity or holiness. So this is where next week I will just cover broadly chapter 4, 5, 6. And then finally, the fourth point that John Stott says is this new relationships into which God has brought us, harmony in the home and hostility to the devil. Okay, so this will help you to see where this book is going. Now, but today, we are going to focus only on chapter 1 to 3. So in chapter 1 to 3, if you look at the next slide, You see this, I put a hamburger there, okay? Again, if you know, you know. Meaning, from day one, since the church started, I've been trying to share with you chiasm. Bread on top, bread below, and in the middle is the message or the meat. So, if you look at chapter 1 to 3, it is a very good, like a hamburger. With the top, chapter 1, begins with a praise to God. And the end of chapter 3, a praise to God. In between, you have prayers, and then with a center, a message. Okay? So when you break up a few chapters of a book into a structure like this, when you look into it, it's clearer, it's easier. Now, this kind of structure is actually resembles a liturgy of a church service. So earlier on in our church service, we had praise and worship. Then I came up here and I prayed. Then now I'm doing a sermon. And what? Guess what I'm going to do after the sermon finishes? I'm going to pray. And then what will we do after I pray? We will get the musicians come out and we will all sing again, praise to God. Do you understand how Paul, as a writer and author, will be thinking as he writes this book to the church? So what we're going to do is, do you see those words in blue? Today, I'm just going to focus on A prime, and C, the message. Okay, because we don't have a lot of time, so I'm just going to give you the overview of this structure. So let's go to A first. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. Okay, that's part 1A. As I said, which is this passage is what Cassandra just read for us. As I said earlier on, it's one long sentence in Greek. And it's made out of 202 Greek words. So because it's such a long sentence, again, we need to break it down. So next slide, please. We need to break it down to help us to see that there is also a structure in verses 3 to 14. And it begins like this, okay? Next slide, we break it down. You'll see it starts with A, okay? And that is, let me just read to you. The Father chose us in Christ from the beginning. In love, He predestined us for adoption according to the purpose of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace in the Beloved. Key things I want you to pay attention to are words like He chose us, He predestined us by His will. This A is going to mirror the next A prime at the end. Later you're going to see that. And again, you're going to see Paul mentioning God's will predestined. What does this tell us? It tells us that your salvation and my salvation was not actually because we prayed. Somehow, somebody in time came to a point where we say, oh God in heaven, we are living in sin, so please send your Son to die for us on the cross so that we can be saved. No, none of us, nobody thought of that. All of these, the whole plan of salvation was God's initiative. That's why it's by grace. It is His determined will and purpose that He predestined even before time that we will be saved in Christ in this manner. Okay? Now, number two is that when you look at verses 3 to 14, there are so many ways we can look at this verse. Scholars, they differ in how to approach it. But everyone would agree that it is talking about Christ. That Christ is central. That this whole salvation, this whole message, this whole blessing is in Christ. That's why you will see words like in Him, in Him, in Him. And finally, you also will see the triune God being mentioned. You will see Christ, you will see blessed be God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, and then you will see the Holy Spirit. So in other words, the whole work of salvation is the work of God in its entirety. God the Father's will, through Jesus Christ, His Son, and then he completes it by giving us the Holy Spirit. So very amazing, beautiful verses 3 to 14. Okay, so this is the first part. Now, let's look at the A prime, the mirror. You see those words? We were chosen in him to obtain an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of his will. Do you see that? It's the same as what we read earlier on. To the praise of his glory in Christ. All right, so if this is the complete picture that it is in Christ, then the last part, it ends with the sealed with the Holy Spirit. So let's look at the next slide. So when you see the next slide, yeah. You see here, in him, you who believe in the gospel were sealed with the Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance to the praise of his glory. So what is this? Why is it so special about this seal? So in those times, if you have a slave or an animal, you can actually put a seal on them. And what that means is this slave or this animal belongs to me. That's why it is a seal. So our salvation is in Christ. And then Paul says, when you believe in this gospel, when you put your faith in Christ, how does God tell the whole world that you belong to him? He gives you the Holy Spirit as a seal that you belong to him. Like that. So it completes the picture. So if that is the bread on the top and the bread below, then let's look at the middle. Okay, so the B, this is what it says here. In him, we have redemption through his blood. This is the message, right? So, yes, it's God's determined purpose. It is his will. But what is the gist? What is the main salvation? How does God accomplish his salvation? It is through Christ's death. He are redeemed. Why is it that he could seal us? Because redemption is like somebody comes and buys you, purchases you. But he purchased you through his blood, and then he forgives your trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose in Christ, to unite all things in heaven and earth in him. So this is the core message of chapter 1. Now, so we summarize all that I said earlier on in this slide. The few key points from these 14 verses, which is really one long sentence I said earlier, is this. God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all at work to accomplish our salvation and adoption into God's family. He redeems us and forgives our sins. Salvation is God's wisdom, by God's grace, predestined according to God's will, to be in Christ, for the Jews first, and then through them to the Gentiles. The we and us in that passage, first person plural, refers to the Jews. The you, the second person plural, refers to the Gentiles. In Christ, the we, us, you, and they, everyone are united as one. Very rich, one sentence in the Greek, original Greek language, but it captures the whole gospel message. So in summary, we can say all that verses in and put it into one sentence. Blessed be the God and Father of Jesus Christ, because he chose us and redeemed us in Christ and sealed all who believe with the Holy Spirit for his glory. Get it? Now, why is this important? Because I gave you the background. The background is they were worshipping Artemis, believing that she had the fate, like, because she had the zodiac sign, right? So these passages here, these verses here, shows us that your faith and my faith is not in Artemis. It's not even in the zodiac sign. It is in God, who right from the beginning, already in his will and his mind, in his wisdom, already chose you and I to be saved in Christ. To belong to His family, to forgive your sins and your trespasses and redeem you so that you can be part of His family and seal you with the Holy Spirit. You do not need to, I don't know how is your upbringing, I do not know your background, as in like, do you have people telling you that, oh, you were born in a certain year, 你的八字不合, or you are, you know, when you're born, you this, that thing, this bad luck thing happened, this feng shui master say this. Actually, this scripture tells us, it doesn't matter. You are saved and redeemed in Christ. Amen. Amen. So, to the praise of His glory, blessed be God of our Lord Jesus Christ. So, that is the first praise, the first bread of the hamburger. Now, then we look at the bottom. Now, we go to Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. And we look at the praise. Now, this praise is glory to the Father in the church and in Christ Jesus. So let's look at the verses. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20 to 21. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. This to Him be glory. All right? Where will God receive glory? It's in the scripture. Where will He receive glory? The answer is in the church and in Christ Jesus. Now, when I read this passage, right, in my mind, and I think you will also agree, if you say God is going to receive glory in Christ, I don't think you have any problem because Christ is perfect, He's His Son. So God should receive glory in Christ. But then when you think of God is going to receive glory in the church, and you go like, oh, the church. I like God, I like, but it's the church that I cannot stand. It's the people. I'm disappointed, right? I'm hurt by people in the church. So how is God going to receive glory in the church? But this verse tells us that Christ and the church are inseparable. When you have Christ, you have the church. When you have church, you have Christ, because the church is His body. So it's not up to you and I to be able to separate and say that I love God, I worship Him, but just don't ask me to be involved in church. Just don't ask me to be a part of the church. That's not how it works. But what is even more amazing to me is the next part. How long is this going to be? The Bible says, throughout all generations, forever and ever. This plan of God to receive glory in Christ and in the church is not going to change. It doesn't matter how you look at the church. God is not going to change the way He is going to receive glory. So then we have to ask ourselves, so in what way can I change my lens in looking at the church? How? How can I hope that, I mean, first of all, we also know ourselves that we are fallen and we are imperfect. And so we hurt others, others hurt us. So we even don't have hope in ourselves, right? So how am I going to have hope in the church? Later on, as we go through the scripture, you are going to see where you can place your hope in. We can see that God, because God is not going to change the way He approaches the church, we can have this hope that God will do His work, His perfect work in us, in all of us. And I want to say this, that the church has existed and lasted for the last 2,000 years, since Christ and the apostles. And I'm confident that if Jesus tarries for another 1,000 years, that the church will still be around. You say, why are you so confident? It's simply because of this verse that says, forever and ever for all generations. Can you be so confident that any other companies in the world, okay, all your top companies in the US today, the big brands, can you be so confident that 1,000 years later, they will still be around? Go in. Let's ask ourselves this question. Where is that big business in the first century? What's the brand? Do you know? I don't know, because nobody existed already. There were certain companies when we were growing up, okay, and that we will always think these are big companies, big names. But today, those companies are dwindling in size and they are soon forgotten. But not for the church. Not for the church. So because the church and Christ is inseparable, sometimes when you have people that ask, why should I believe? You know, I grew up, I have my certain faith, my belief, my parents tells me this, how I should believe and pray. But why should I now come to church and believe in God and in Jesus? I have never seen God, I've never seen Jesus. Why should I believe? My answer will be, when you see the church, you know that Jesus exists. Because without Jesus, there's no church. Even though I don't physically see Jesus now, but I see the church. This is a testament. The church is the testament to God's new creation work. The new humanity, the new society, as John Stott calls it, united in Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit. That's what Ephesians is trying to show us. And that is the gist, the main message that Paul is trying to bring. A new humanity. This new humanity, as we have seen earlier in chapter 1, is a humanity or a society, a community that is redeemed, right, by Christ through His blood. And their sins are forgiven. So you need to see the church from this higher, broader, and grander vision. This grander vision, basically I'm saying, what do I mean by this grander vision is, I'm saying, it's not about attending a church service. Do not just think that, oh, pastor, you're trying to encourage us to attend a church service. No, I want you to see the church. You are the church. You are God's family. We all belong to the church, not like a staff belonging to a company. For you to work in a company, you need to have credentials, experience, education, certain skill sets. That's why you can work in that company. There is a reason why you belong there. But that's not for the church. You don't come to the church or you don't belong to the body of Christ by any reason, nothing to do with your experience, your education, but purely by grace. You don't even belong, okay, for example, you belong to a biological family, we call earthly family, because you have the same biological parents. But here, you belong to God's family, not by biology, not by physical bloodline, but by faith in Jesus Christ, by God's grace. Super amazing, because then you have everyone from every tongue and every tribe and every nation coming together and calling each other as brothers and sisters by virtue of Christ and what He has done for us. Now, so what is so special about church? What is so special about church? How does it all come together? Now we come to the meat in the hamburger, right? The message that Paul was trying to say. So, again, this message is such a long passage, I break it down for you in three different segments. By first talking about how God is the one who saves. He draws different ones together. Then, the next slide, please. Then it moves to the next segment, which is how they are to reconcile with one another. So God picks people from different places, put them together, reconcile, and then the final part is how you and I as a man, how do we respond to God? So how God reaches to man, how man relates to one another, and how we relate to God. So you can see this is Paul's message. Now let's look at this God to man, okay? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. He says, and you were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. Okay, there are two kinds of children here. It's in the scripture. What are the two kinds? Sons of disobedience and children of wrath. So who are they? The you were dead in trespasses, are the sons of disobedience. And actually, if you read the context, you're referring to the Gentiles. Because in the context it says, you were following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit that is at work. Which I told you, that's right, the background of the book of Ephesians or the background in Ephesus is very important because you were seeing that they are very superstitious people. Right? Sons of disobedience, actually they are fallen away. They do not know who Yahweh is. But God saves them. Now what about the children of wrath? He says that, but we all once walked in the passions of the flesh. The we are the children of wrath. He's referring to the Jews. Why? Because they are supposed to be people who know God and they know the laws of Moses. But they rebelled. That's why we have the book of Isaiah, that they were taken into exile in Babylon because of their rebellion. And so, they are called the children of wrath. Now, it doesn't matter whether you are children of disobedience or children of wrath. This is what the Bible says in Ephesians 2 verse 10. And this is the key, okay? It says here, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. The hope that I have in the church is not the hope in ourselves. The hope I have is in this verse, that all of us are God's workmanship. That means God is like the potter, you are the clay. You can fall, you can make mistakes, you can fail in the past. But you are still God's children, you are still in His hands. He is still molding you. You are WIP. What's WIP? You are work in progress. And God, in His mind, has a vision for your life to prepare you for good works. So I know that we all may have at various times in our life, right, experience hurts, grief, disappointments by people in church, by church as a whole, by leaders in church. But the only way that we can break out of that is to understand that we are all still under God's grace, that He is still molding and shaping us. Do you understand? And how we see, and where is He bringing us to? Ephesians chapter 5, which I will share next week, but I just show you first. Okay, Ephesians 5 tells us, verses 1 and 8 says, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children. That means from sons of disobedience, children of wrath, to become beloved children. That's where God is bringing you to. And He says in verse 8, for at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Don't give up on yourself. Don't give up on others. Pray for them that they will eventually come to become children of light. Amen. Amen. Children of wisdom, children of truth. So, I want to give you this reflection question. And I want you to think, can you see yourself and others as God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works? That means from sons of disobedience, children of wrath, to become beloved children, children of light. Because if you say, I can, then that may be your way to find healing and to begin to forgive those who have hurt you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because if you cannot answer this question with a genuine yes, the hurt is so deep, then that's where you find that, hey, it's almost like saying, everyone deserves forgiveness, everyone deserves salvation, but not that person. So you see how Paul begins his message by saying, God, this is how God saves all of us. Then, now he talks about reconciling men and men. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 to 18 in the passage. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, meaning the Jews, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, meaning the Gentiles, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Do you see the consistency in his message from chapter 1 all the way now to chapter 2? Verse 14, for he himself, meaning Christ, is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace. Two different groups of people. Today, I preached in a Chinese service. After the Chinese service, Xiao Ming was sharing with me that this wall of separation, that Bible scholars and some people have read it as the temple. That actually the temple was meant to be a temple, a house of prayer for all nations, but the Jews have made it their own temple and have this wall has separated the Gentiles from the Jews, separated the Gentiles from God. And so in Christ Jesus, that wall is removed, so that we can all be one in Christ and then to the Father. So let's continue. Verse 16. And might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, through Christ, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. No longer through the temple, but through the Holy Spirit, through Christ, to the Father. Isn't this so amazing? Again, I say, none of us thought of it. It is God's wisdom. It is God's will. It is God's grace. So, we see this. Paul says, Jesus is our peace. Jesus came as a peacemaker. And not only that, he preached peace. What about us? What about us? If this was our founder, the founder of Christianity, if this was our Savior, that he came as a peacemaker and he preached peace, then if you know who you're following, then you will also be a peacemaker and be reconciled with one another. And you will preach peace to others. And that's what I mean by, if you read the book of Ephesians, this is the gist of the message, but we may not remember these passages as important, thinking that there are other verses that are more important. We must be not only asking God to forgive us our sins, but also forgiving the sins of others. We need to think about peace. You know, in church, right, we have been in church for a long time. Certain things, right, the things that really break up relationship are really the most incredibly minor things. Thank God our church, right, we don't have like flower arrangement, okay? But I can tell you, okay, you can split a church, you can split a cell group by simply things like, where do you put the flowers? Do you understand what I'm saying? How do you place the chair, right? Where do the musicians stand today, right? How do we play this song? It's all these little things. What kind of chair should we buy? What kind of keyboard should we buy? What kind of equipment should we buy? It's all these things. And you ask yourself, you read the book of Ephesians, and you see what Christ has done for you in order to bring peace. And then when you come together as a church, you are squabbling, you are quarreling over all these small little things. It just doesn't make sense because you don't see the book. And what is the main message? What is the gist of it? Once you get it, then you tell yourself, 大事化小,小事化无. Just forget about all this they are not so crucial or important. Reconcile with each other. Be peacemakers. Amen? So now, as you can see this passage, right? Now the response, okay? Man's response to God. And now Paul writes of himself in the first person. Chapter 3, verse 1 to 2. Paul says, "For this reason, after I share all these things, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you." Paul understood that he was saved by God, by grace, and he understood that God's purpose is for Jews and Gentiles to come together as one. He says, "My response is I have been given this stewardship and I must serve God. I must respond to Him." So, his stewardship, alright? We go on to the point number two, which is his response is to be a minister of this gospel. He says, verse 6, "This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of His power." So you see, his response is, "I now am a minister of this gospel to preach to the Gentiles, to preach to the Gentiles." Verse 8, "To me, though I'm the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of God, or of Christ." So therefore, what I'm trying to say is this. So after you understand this big picture, our response is, as I say, therefore your response should not be about what are the minor things that is causing all this division. You should be preaching peace. You should be a peacemaker yourself as a person. You should be preaching and reaching out to people who are different from you and accepting them to come to the church and welcome them without much like expectation for them to conform to our culture, so to speak. Let's be that welcoming and that accepting and that inclusive as a church. Point number three. So Paul's hope, and that is his vision, his understanding, is that the wisdom of God might be made manifest through the church. So how is Christ, how is God going to receive glory in Christ and through the church? When you read this message, this meat of this hamburger, you now begin to understand that really where there can be peace and unity in diversity is in the church. But very often, the church fails in this area. Really, who can broker peace? Who can be a broker of peace? The church. But very often, we fail in that. But we must see this is the message. So, right? Are you with me? So, if you look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9 to 10, it says, "And to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places." I always have this vision, like that's why I say it's like Paul's vision, this hope, this, you can say is a naivety, but when two rulers, when two nations cannot talk to each other, I've always imagined that the church, that these two nations, the churches in these two nations can work together and talk to each other. And so how amazing it will be if we can do that. So this is Paul's testimony, all right? That is what we just seen. That he understands that by God's grace, he now receives salvation in Christ. And God reveals to him the mystery that the Gentiles are to be one body with the Jews in Christ. So Paul responds to this stewardship and becomes a minister of this gospel of grace and this gospel of peace. So my question is, what about us, or what about you? Do we understand and do we do the same? So what have we seen today is that we have seen these four things. Number one, that the church is chosen by God, redeemed in Christ, and sealed with the Holy Spirit. The church is called to the ministry of reconciliation as peacemakers, and God will receive eternal glory in the church and in Christ. And that in Christ, we are His workmanship created for good works. If you can put these four things together and process in your mind, you have hope, great hope for the church, that indeed God is going to receive glory in the church and in Christ. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand, shall we? Hallelujah. Amen. Musicians, if you can just come. So let's just close our eyes and let's just pray. I have asked the musicians to sing a song, actually. It's a very old song, not familiar to many of us, but the lyrics is very beautiful. And it's about peace, about being, seeking peace, understanding each other so that we can have peace. Because we're going to have communion. So I'm going to ask you just to be seated, let them sing. As they sing the song, think about the lyrics, and then we will pray. Shall we do that? So, Father, I just thank you for the book of Ephesians. We thank you for what Christ has done for us. He shed his blood to redeem us in order to forgive us our trespasses, that we can become children of light. It doesn't matter that whether in the past we were sons of disobedience or children of wrath, but today we can be beloved children of God. Help us, O God, to make peace. Help us to be peacemakers. And as a church, understand that this is the beauty of the gospel, that this is what Christ, you came to do for us. Let us find strength, O God, in you to forgive. Find strength in you to be healed of our hurts, our resentment, and our anger. Today, O God, let this song minister to us. Let it be a reflection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Demonstrated with your life to forgive, to love, to be a channel of grace, a channel of peace. I pray for our church, pray for all of us, Lord, that in our families, in our workplace, and wherever we are in all our relationships, that we will be a channel of your peace. That we will be there to counsel, we'll be there to be a peacemaker. We're there, God, to demonstrate our willingness, Lord, to take the first step of carrying the cross, our willingness to forgive. Jesus, do that work in all our hearts. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Just please be seated down. We can sing this song again maybe later. Let's just partake of the Holy Communion together. I think it's so appropriate as we reflect on this song and reflect on the message, and then to read what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body broken for you.'" I'm just so touched because Christ came to be the example of self-sacrifice and self-giving. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me." Do what? It's not, yes, we are partaking of this element, and by doing this, you will remember him. But more than that, I believe it's also doing the same thing that then now we can say, "My body for you, my life, whatever God has blessed me with, if I can be a peacemaker, if I can serve, if I can help you, then for you, I will do it for you." So that in doing so, I remember what Christ has done for me. Then he says, "In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Hallelujah. You know, church, here we're all seated down. There may be in our mind there's flashback of people that have hurt us or grieved us. As we partake of this Holy Communion, let's take this time to really allow the Lord to heal us. To let God restore and maybe even reconcile relationships. Dear Lord, we thank you for this bread, that it is the body of Christ. As we partake of it, Lord, let it again not only remind us of what you have done, but give us the strength to do what you have done for us, that we can also forgive and give self-sacrificially. May you, O God, bless this bread and this cup that we are to partake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Church, the body of Jesus was broken for us. Let's eat up. And let's drink of the cup together. Amen. You may pass the empty cup to the house, or the ushers will serve you and help you. Maybe we sing it one more time. Now I invite you to stand up, and now we sing this song from the beginning properly, and let it be our prayer today. All right? Make me a channel. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Today in the benediction, I will read from Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20, the verses that we read today. So now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. So may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen and amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand today. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you're blessed today. Right, we'll come back again next week for chapter 4 to 6. All right. So God bless. Have a great weekend.